Brother Hassan from New York and also Sister, I think, Mehnaz from California. I got actually 4 emails in the last weeks about the same issue. I'm going to summarize it. And it's a very sensitive topic. The emails all say the same scenario. A female relative has decided to marry a person of another faith. And now the question arises, what is to be done? She's adult. She's free to do whatever she wants, you know, politically and technically. And in one case, the uncle, in the other case, a cousin, in the other case, a family friend is asking, should we attend the ceremony? And what do we do afterwards? And what is the verdict on a Muslim, a Muslimah, having a nikah with a kitabi or even a non-kitabi, even somebody who's agnostic or atheist? So this is the question. Is the wedding permissible? Should we attend the wedding? What is to be done afterwards?
وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِن قَبْلِكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ.
Before I jump into the answer to this question, I do need to take a bit of a step back and address a segment of people who find the entire question problematic. And they say, why does it bother you if somebody has chosen their life partner, they're in love with them, they want to be happy together, why do you have to interfere? And in particular, many people that are living in a liberal paradigm, they find it problematic that we problematize somebody else's marriage. You understand the point here, right? If they're getting married, that's their happiness, let them do it. And we need to be very frank here. Fact of the matter is, somebody who finds our problematizing problematic, right? They're coming from a very different paradigm. And I, inshallah, plan to give lectures about this as well. But their paradigm is essentially a modern version of liberalism, which is extremely dismissive of religious values, of religious conservatism. And in our times, the way that modern values have progressed, it is self-evident. Once upon a time, 100 years ago, even 50 years ago, a person always thought of himself or herself in relationship to one's family, in relationship to one's community, in relationship to one's society. Nowadays, the concern completely is on myself, me, myself, and I. What do I want? Once upon a time, people valued community. These days, it is the individual. Once upon a time, people looked at the spiritual and physical well-being. These days, it's just, what do I desire? What is my shahwa? And essentially, what we see, modern liberalism, is, as Allah says in the Quran, أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهَهُ هَوَاهُ. Have you not seen the one who has taken his passions as his God? I have said many times, modern, postmodern liberalism is essentially this, where my desires become my religion, my deen. Their tawheed, worship, is to worship their desires. So then what will shirk be? Anyone who comes between them and their desires. And that's why they cannot stand anyone who says, don't act upon your impulses. Just because you feel a shahwa, just because you feel a temptation, why do you have to act upon it? For their paradigm, this is shirk. Literally, no exaggeration. Because their tawheed is the worship of their desires. Right? And that's what we see in our modern culture, is that what is your identity? How do you feel? Okay? What are you exploring your own inner, whatever they, you know, they want to do? Essentially, it boils down to, what do I want to do? Nobody has the right to tell me other than that. And it is difficult for somebody in that paradigm to even begin to understand our paradigm. Because our paradigm is that the individual is never an individual. The individual is also a mother or father, is also a brother or sister, is also a member in a society. The individual, most importantly, is a worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you can't just put aside this individual and ignore community, society, dunya, akhirah. You can't do that. And sometimes this works for open-minded liberals, because liberals sometimes are the most bigoted people, even though they claim to be the most open-minded. And this is the irony, by the way, of liberal values. Technically, liberalism says tolerate all opinions, okay? But the fact of the matter is that as long as nobody is forced or physically harmed. Yet this modern version of liberalism is militantly fundamentalist. It doesn't even allow you in your personal life to hold an opinion that goes against their values. Even if you don't, like, you're not forcing anybody. I have an opinion about marriage, about sexuality. It's my opinion. Why can't I have it? But for me to merely have it, it is as if I have committed shirk in their eyes, because it is their shirk, right? Because my values, right, impede with their values. And so the irony is that the system that claims to respect all views ends up being extremely disrespectful to any view that is not within its spectrum. So we have to begin by pointing that out. The bottom line, as I said, us religious folks, we have many factors that we look at, and not just the person's desires. It's not just about what do I want. It's about what. And if you want to explain to somebody from a liberal paradigm, you can say, what would you do if your best friend, if your cousin, if your sister or brother became a drug addict? What would you do? I'm not comparing a person's love with addiction. I'm comparing the concept. Why would you intervene and say, oh, I do mind that he wants to have cocaine. His desires are harmful to him, the liberal would say. We say, and we believe, certain desires are also harmful. You might not believe them, but understand where we're coming from. Not every desire is useful. Not every desire is healthy. Not every love is necessarily good for you. That's what we believe. Who tells us what is right and wrong? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who tells you what is right and wrong? Majority opinion changes. Every few years there's something new. Democracy is when the natural logical conclusion is that even ethical values become up to the majority vote. And I have to give this long disclaimer, because I have to be brutally honest here. You know, these videos, they go online and people cut snippets and paste and like, oh, look at this fundamentalist preacher. He's telling people they shouldn't marry whom they love. And I say, look, we have the right to preach whatever we want. Even as we understand the freedom of this country, we cannot force anybody. And that's why it's problematic. We are finding many women of our faith decide to marry people outside the faith. We have to be very frank here. We cannot force. What can we do? We can speak. We can have feelings, just like she has feelings. Why can we also not? And we can try to argue and negotiate. But in the end of the day, if she insists and she is an adult, what are you going to do? In terms of technical, I'm not talking about Islamic law. What are you going to do? So we have to be very clear about this issue. That long introduction, let us now answer the fiqhi question. Do we believe it is allowed to marry a person outside of our faith tradition? We know that the Quran explicitly forbids a Muslim man or a Muslim woman from marrying a mushrik. وَلَا تَنْكُحُ الْمُشْرِكِينَ and وَلَا تُنْكُحُ الْمُشْرِكَاتِ. It is explicit in the Quran. Men and women cannot marry mushrik. And the term shirk applies to anyone who worships other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even somebody who rejects Allah is committing a type of shirk, because they have taken themselves and their egos as objects of worship besides Allah. So from a technical perspective, even those who believe that God has a son, that is a type of shirk as well. So all of this is included in shirk, because they are worshipping and believing in a God other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's a general rule. Muslim man and woman cannot marry mushrik. Now, one exception comes, that's in Surah Al-Baqarah. One exception comes in Surah Al-Ma'idah. Allah says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, one of the last revelations that was revealed, that it is allowed for you men to marry a kitabi lady, if they are chaste. Meaning if they are not acting in a lewd and a lascivious manner, they are living a dignified life, a Muslim man may marry a kitabi lady. This is a gender-specific exception. A man may marry a lady, that is a kitabi. Because it is so explicitly gendered in the Quran, the opposite, a Muslim lady marrying a kitabi man, is forbidden from the generalities of the previous verse. And it is because of this that there is unanimous consensus that a lady of a Muslim background is not allowed to marry anybody outside of Islam, whether that person is Kitabi or whether that person is other than a Kitabi. And I say ijma' here, and I kind of go over the Quran in this regard, because in Islamic law, believe it or not, I know it sounds strange for the person who hasn't studied usul al-fiqh, but the number one source that is the strongest source of Islamic law is actually ijma'. In terms of the strongest, it is ijma'. Why? Because a verse of the Quran is open to interpretation. The Hanafis might say this, the Shafi'is might say that. When you have ijma', what you are saying is that there has never been any controversy in this regard. And this is one of those few issues in our religion where there is unanimous consensus of all the scholars of Islam that a Muslim lady cannot marry outside of the faith. Imam Malik mentions in his Mudawwana, his student wrote this, that don't you see that it is not allowed for a Muslimah to marry a Nasrani or a Yahudi in any circumstance? Imam al-Shafi'i mentions in his Ahkam al-Quran that it is haram for a Muslim to marry a mushrik, whether they are from idolaters or whether they are from the Ahli Kitab. Imam al-Qurtubi mentions in his Al-Jami' that it is never allowed for a Muslimah to marry a non-Muslim, and there is ijma' of the Ummah on this point. Imam al-Razi says the same thing. Ibn Qudam in his Mughni says, it is never in any circumstance allowed for a kafir to marry a Muslimah. There is never allowed, and in fact, there is ijma' on this point. Ibn Qudama says this. Ibn al-Munzir, who wrote one of the earliest books of ijma', Ibn al-Munzir is a scholar of the 4th century or 5th century, early 5th century, who wrote one of the first books on ijma', and he lists in that little treatise what has the ummah agreed upon. One of the points, ajma'a ala kulli man nahfaza anhu min ahli al-ilm. All of the people I have ever met, and he was one of the scholars who traveled far and wide, they have ijma' that it is not allowed for a Muslimah to marry a Kitabi or a Mushrik. So it is something that is explicitly clear, even in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, when Muslims, ladies converted and they came to Medina, the Sahaba were wondering, should we return them back to Mecca? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Allah, Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed in the Quran, do not return Muslima ladies to their husbands. لَهُنَّ حِلُّ لَهُمْ وَلَهُمْ حِلُّ لَهُمْ. Neither are they allowed for them, nor are they allowed for them. Meaning neither are their ex-wives allowed for the ex-husbands, nor are the ex-husbands allowed for their ex-wives. This is a well-known incident the Quran was revealed because of. Now, before I move on, two quick points. This might shock some of you, but it is my humble opinion, based on the fatwa of Ibn Abbas and many scholars, that the opposite is also not allowed in cases of living in non-Muslim lands. Meaning, in my humble opinion, I do not consider it permissible for a Muslim man to marry a Kitabi lady except in the lands of Islam. This is my opinion. It is the opinion of many people before me and many people in our times. When Allah allowed a Muslim man to marry a Kitabi lady, Ibn Abbas said, this is for the lands of Islam. Not allowed when the court systems are not following the laws of Islam. Because when a Muslim man marries a Kitabi lady in the lands of Islam and a divorce happens, the Sharia will judge that the children be raised as Muslims. That is not the case in lands outside of Islam. Also, I bring the quote of Umar ibn al-Khattab when he forbade the Muslims who settled in Iraq to marry the Kitabi ladies. They wrote back and they said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, it's allowed. And in his case, he said, I'm not saying it's haram. He said that. But if every man amongst you married a Kitabi lady, who would marry our women? So he forbade it as a matter of siyasa, of political jurisdiction, not as a matter of fiqh. Ibn Abbas said, from a technical perspective, even from a fiqhi perspective, a Muslim man cannot marry a Kitabi lady when the laws of the land are not going to be supporting the children's Islam. And this is something that I personally follow, but I know there's ikhtilaf, so if somebody has another position, that is fine. So, in my humble opinion, neither a man nor a woman can marry outside the faith in the country we reside in. It is only allowed to marry within the faith. This is my opinion. That's why I have never in my life performed a nikah between a Muslim man and a Kitabi lady. This is my opinion. As I said, I'm not putting it binding on anybody else. I'm just giving you my position. Another exception that the European Fiqh Council has given a fatwa on, and I agree with this as well, is that this verdict of a kitabi applies only when the marriage is beginning. A Muslima wants to marry a kitabi, we say not allowed. However, if a couple is Christian or Jewish and the lady converts to Islam, so the marriage took place and they're both kitabis, then the one partner converts. If the husband converts, no problem, because the majority say that the Muslim man is allowed to marry a kitabi lady, correct? And even in this case, I say no problem. I mean, this is a different thing. You understand? But what if it's the opposite? What if the lady converts and the husband does not convert? The European Fiqh Council has released a fatwa, and one of my mentors and somebody I consider a teacher, Sheikh Abdullah Al-Judair, has written a book on this, Islam Wahid Al-Zawjain. It's a very good book. And this was the fatwa of Umar ibn Khattab and Ali ibn Abi Talib in their khilafah. In their khilafah, it happened, both of their khilafahs, that a lady converted and her husband did not. They had a family and she said, I don't want to leave. I'm happy here. He's allowed me to be Muslim. So they wrote to Medina. These incidents took place far away. They wrote to Medina, and in both cases, in Umar radiallahu anhu's fatwa and in Ali radiallahu anhu's fatwa, he said, okay, in that case, let them remain. So an exception was made for somebody who converts as long as she can practice her faith. Is it healthy? No. But is the marriage batil? As long as she can practice Islam, my position, the Fiqh Council also said this, European Fiqh Council, the American Fiqh Council hasn't said anything, but I know internally we follow this position as well. It is permissible for the marriage to be maintained. You are not allowed to initiate a marriage, but to maintain, in Arabic it's called istishab al-asad, you presume the continuity. The continuity of the marriage is permissible, but not the initiation of a marriage. Is that clear? Okay. With this fiqhi background, let us now conclude with the big question. What is to be done? She's decided. We say it's not allowed. We say there is no nikah. We say this nikah is batil. You can have a civil marriage, you can make the registration, the government considers it a valid ceremony and a valid marriage, we understand that. From our perspective, the nikah is batil, it doesn't exist. What is to be done now? This is the whole issue. There is no religious fatwa that can be given. This is now a matter of psychology, not legality. What is to be done if somebody whom you love insists on disobeying Allah and His Messenger? The problem comes here. What is our ultimate goal? Is it for us to punish them or is it for us to guide them? I'm asking you. To guide them. Okay. So the goal here, if they've declared we want to do something haram, the goal here is to guide them. How you guide somebody, how you influence somebody is not fiqh, it is psychology. So, one of the most common genre of questions us people get asked, the shuyukh and the ulama and whatnot, one of the most common genre, Shaykh, I have a friend who does X, Y, and D, what should I do? Shaykh, I have a relative who does this, what is the best way to give da'wah to them? And my response is always the same, you know best. You're asking a psychology question, not a legal question. What is the best way to give da'wah is not fiqh. That is human psychology. And who knows your friend? You or me? Who knows your cousin? You or me? Who knows your brother or sister? You or me? You do. So what is the next step? You and your family needs to come together and have a frank discussion. What do we need to do to try our best to influence this person in the short or in the long term? And that question, nobody on a podium, on a pulpit, from a sheikh's paradigm can answer as well as you can. We can give you generic guidelines. So when this is going to happen, you've tried to discuss, she is adamant, she's going to go forth with it, what can you do? You have to come together as a family, and without this individual, or even with the individual as well, and discuss what are the next steps we should take. And generically speaking, I mean, because there's always exceptions. Sometimes a person might be best that you withdraw from them, emotionally cut off, and they're going to feel a sense of we need to change for the better. That will influence them. Sometimes being angry and rebuking will work. But generally speaking, a little bit of compassion works more than a little bit of harshness. This is the general rule. A little bit of kindness, hurt love, will work better than anger and spouting and whatnot. So, and that's because people go through phases. Right now, she's passionately in love with her colleague or coworker. Right now, she's not thinking straight. As all of us who are above the age of 30, 40, you know, I mean, love is something, mashallah, it's nice when you're a teenager, but, you know, life goes on. I mean, you know, it's like that teenage love that happens, or the first love when she's getting married, she's not going to feel the same way in 5, 10 years. Everybody knows this, okay? So, what do you want to do? You want to burn all bridges so that 5 years down the line, when she softens up, when she feels an emptiness, when she realizes I don't have a connection with my Creator, and then she also realizes I don't have a family, what's going to happen? She's going to dig herself in deeper. She's going to find other ties. I've even heard of very rarely where she converts to Christianity. Not because she necessarily believes, but she needs a faith-based community. And her whole masjid and family have completely boycotted. What do you think is going to happen psychologically? So my general rule, but again, there are always exceptions, is there should be what I call hurt love. Hurt love. There can never be ignoring what she has done. Now I have to be clear here. You cannot just go back to status quo. You cannot just say, okay, fine, she's decided, tough luck, life goes on. Why? Would you do that if she was a drug addict, if he was a drug addict? Would you do that if they are selling drugs? No, you're always going to show, I'm not happy with this lifestyle. I don't like what you're doing. But they're still your biological daughter, cousin, niece. That's never going to change. So you have to balance between that ties of kinship and between showing that you're just not happy. And again, there's no fiqhi ruling here, but I would speak generically. And again, you judge best. I would say the following. My humble opinion, the generic rule, the immediate family, of course, friends, it doesn't even come in because why would you, you're not, as a friend, it's easier to step back. But a generic, family, immediate family, in my humble opinion, going to the marriage is a bit too much because you are explicitly endorsing something that is a blatant rejection of Allah's Sharia. My humble opinion, I don't see a justification of you just... Because when you go, what, you're going to be scowling all the time, looking angry? I mean, be realistic here, okay? What would be the purpose of you going? In this case, your presence is tacit approval. Generally speaking, this is what I would say. However, you can't just cut off ties of kinship, can you? I mean, she's your daughter or your niece or your cousin. What are you going to do? Once kids come, what are you going to do then? I mean, definitely, I hope nobody will take their anger out on the kids. The kids have not done anything wrong that they deserve to have anything from you different. They are your biological mahram. Even if the marriage is batil, by the way, right? If you're the father or the nephew, the uncle, those are your biological mahrams. You cannot marry them. Even if the marriage is batil, you get the point here. There is a something kinship that you have. And also, it's not the fault of the kids. And also, shouldn't you even more now be a positive Islamic role model in the lives of these innocent children when they don't have one otherwise, right? So again, we have to bring a psychological issue that perhaps some scholars are not understanding when they give very explicit fatwas. I've heard them myself. Cut off all contact and don't associate them. I mean, I'm sorry, but that's a human element that you're not taking into account. How can you cut off all contact with your own son or daughter if they're committing a sin? Even if, a'udhu billah, they have left Islam, in the end of the day, they're still your son and daughter, aren't they? There has to be some relationship, even as you demonstrate, what did I call it? What was the term? Hurt love, okay? And that hurt love shows to reinforce, like, son, daughter, look, you're still my son, my daughter, I still have those feelings for you, but I'm very hurt at what you've done. In my humble opinion, this is the best mechanism of da'wah. As well, what else can be done when she insists and the marriage takes place? What else can be done? Are you going to never meet the person that she has married on paper? Tell me. What is another goal you should have? Da'wah to this person. How are you going to give da'wah if you're going to spit in his face? I mean, again, there's a human component that we have to be realistic with. May Allah protect us. Wallahi, I say this and I am terrified. May Allah protect us from ever having to face something like this. We don't want it. But what are you going to do if it does happen? There's a human element that I have to be honest about. Are you not going to invite the person over to your house after a week or two when even they know you're angry? Okay, and by the way, before it happens, you should definitely be frank. Definitely, I mean, in the end of the day, it's also not his fault. He's living in a society that allows this. And in his case, it's a typical drama that his whole circle of friends will sympathize with him for. His whole family will support him. He's going to, you know, it's going to be it might even become an HBO movie or something. You know, they're going to make out of it, you know. This is a standard scenario that they're going to love to do. You become the typical bad guy. Stereotypical bad guy. So don't be in that box. Understand what's going on here. From his paradigm, you have no right to stop your daughter. That's the world he's been raised in, right? From our paradigm, our daughter's our daughter. She's always going to be our daughter. Doesn't matter, you know. So the point is that you need to be a little bit more wiser in this regard. Of course, you will invite him over even before. Explain to him why you cannot approve this religiously. Speak to him frankly. And say, what do you want me to do? It's against my faith tradition, and I do not believe this is valid in the eyes of my Creator. And then right then and there say, but I ask you to please think about my faith. I ask you, this is what I believe. Give him the Quran. And then when they're gone, go to your room, fall down in sajda, and cry to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide that person to Islam. What else are you going to do? Make dua sincerely and then show that person the best of Islam outside of the marriage ceremony. Show them what it means to be a Muslim. Because if he does convert, even after a year or two, what can you do? Nikah ceremony right then and there. Alhamdulillah, right? You see the point here. So the goal is that we need to be a little bit realistic given the circumstances we're in. These simplistic fatawa of boycott and cut off, and it doesn't work. There's a human component that has to also be taken into account. And so the bottom line, and with this inshallah ta'ala I conclude, we are very well aware that this is a crisis taking place across this country. For those of you that are not aware, I'm sorry to burst your bubble. Again, from me, you're going to hear blunt truths. This is becoming more and more common. Dare I say, I cannot imagine anyone that has extended family except that this has happened in your own family and my own family. And yes, my own family. It's the reality. Every single one of us. It is the reality of the world that we live in, marrying outside the faith. What is going to happen when this land is less than 1% Muslim? And, you know, this is one of the risks that come with living in this land. Whether it's a Muslim man marrying outside, which I don't believe is allowed as well, or a Muslim lady marrying outside, which is becoming more and more common. And by the way, when it comes to a Muslim man, honestly, we can be more stricter in some ways because there's so many of our sisters unmarried. When it comes to a Muslim lady, even though it is haram, frankly, my heart emotionally kind of understands, because I know of cases in my extended acquaintances where the lady was trying, and nobody within the community proposed, and she kept on saying, that man married a cousin overseas, that man married a Kitabi, that man married a Hispanic convert, that married this and that, who's going to marry me? We literally have had sisters come to our lectures and crying and saying, what can I do? I tried. Should I remain my whole life without having a child? May Allah forgive me, I'm going to do it. Somebody told me this. May Allah forgive me, what else do you want me to do? And I say, you shouldn't do it. But again, it's her choice, right? And I'm not, by the way, please don't read in and take this. Hiya, Anzir. Don't take this 5-second clip and then go online, because like, I have to always deal with this issue. But my point is that I'm not justifying, I'm contextualizing. This is a problem. And dear brothers that are unmarried, please fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and marry from our own communities and sisters. Don't leave and abandon them, even if a position allows you to marry a Kitabi. As Umar ibn Khattab said, if all of our men marry the Kitabi ladies, who will marry our women? And also, by the way, as well, the issue of, nothing wrong with this, but going overseas and coming back. Again, this is, I understand this is happening, but at the same time, we are having a crisis of spinsterhood across North America. Across North America, this is a major problem. And it's not as if our ratios are different. No, 50-50. But two things. Number one, marrying outside the faith. And number two, which is halal, and I understand, going back and then coming in, which is understandable. I'm not saying that's wrong. But again, think about marrying from within. and within the communities. The bottom line, I don't recommend, and I can't generally see a justification for attending the ceremony, because the ceremony is the pinnacle of the whole contract, and you being there is a clear endorsement of batil. And that is where the tough love comes in. You actually tell them, I really love you, I wish the best for you, and because I wish the best for you, I can't just sit there and watch and smile as you undertake this life journey, as much as I would like to, unless you convert to Islam. Put some soft pressure on him. Some soft pressure is halal, okay? Think about the, of course, we want him to convert from the heart, obviously, but some soft pressure is good here. But then afterwards, if the marriage persists, in my humble opinion, there has to be an emotional compromise where it's never status quo. You can never just go back to normal. Every once in a while, no matter how awkward it is, no matter how irritated she gets, every once in a while, the discussion has to come up. Because otherwise, you are just silent in the face of munkar. How often? The language, leave it to you and your psychology and your conscience in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you cannot remain neutral. And then for the person involved, the other, you know, the technical husband or whatnot, da'wah, soft da'wah, whatnot, dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then once kids come, even more so that in the life of the kids, you show what is Islam, you help them pray with you, you know, make them understand Islam, and then lots of dua. What else can we do? And in the end, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect all of us and protect our families and our sons and our daughters. We ask Allah azza wa jalla's refuge from seeing from our sons and daughters that which will break our hearts and make us sad. We ask Allah azza wa jalla to protect our families and make them families of iman and taqwa. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our sons and daughters of those who love the Quran and who love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Oh Allah, make our sons and daughters of those who establish the salah and who pay the zakah and who fast Ramadan. Oh Allah, grant our sons and daughters and our unmarried brothers and sisters righteous spouses from amongst ourselves, oh Allah. Give them spouses that make them the coolness of their eyes and the comfort of their souls, and allow them to come closer to you. Bi rahmatika arhamar rahimin. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam wa baraka alhamdu wa rizal.
لا يزال الخير حيا لا يزال إن في الدنيا سلاما وظلال أخبر الأيام أنها في وصال قم بنا وانظر لآيات الجمال قم بنا وانظر لآيات الجمال.